is appropriate to inaugurate this series here at Temple Emmett, as Bobby served as musical director from 1950 to 1987, when he was taken from us suddenly in the prime of his career. Not only did Mr. Blyly serve as Temple organist and choir director, he was also a prolific composer and arranger. Many of his compositions are still being performed here by our beloved Cantor Candler and at other temples. Tonight, the Zamir Chorale will feature some of Mari's music. A brief resume of Mari's career will give us some insight into this talented man. He studied voice and piano at the New England Conservatory of Music. He was the choir director at Temple Bethel in Chelsea. He served as musical director and organist of the Copley Methodist Episcopal Church. He was music director at the Hebrew Teachers College. He was music director at Temple Emmanuel in Chelsea. He was also music director at Camp Sevilla. Music director at the Seneca Community Players at Eisenhower College in New York, which featured Gilbert and Sullivan productions. He also composed the score for the musical drama Abelard, written by Professor Blackstone at that college. He taught music at other temples in the area, which I have not considered. Liturgical music came naturally to Mari, as his father was a cantor, and Mari studied at the Hebrew Teachers College. When only 17 years old, he was appointed musical director at a local temple. There was an incident that occurred in his early life that only reinforces our appreciation of this quality person. At one time, the combined Protestant choirs of Boston were to perform a concert of church music. Mari was chosen from a long list of musicians to play for these combined choirs. Unfortunately, the concert was scheduled on the same Friday night that Mr. Blyweiss was to lead his temple choir. Needless to say, the temple choir prevailed. On a personal note, I was fortunate to sing with the Temple Emmett's volunteer choir. And to be with this kind, talented man brings back wonderful moments in my life. Mari also taught piano on an individual basis. And after hearing Outdoors perform under Mari's tutelage, my wife Marsha resumed her piano lessons with this gifted teacher. There was piano music in my home night and day. Many of you were not as privileged to know Mari as well as some of us. During services, he would perform in the choir month, which kept him hidden from view. And when not performing, he and his beloved wife Bertha would be unobtrusively mixing with our congregation members. On being with him on various occasions, such as our daily minions, I cherish the moment sitting next to him in conversation, learning from this talented man who would never speak badly of anyone. I remember him being invited to our Zionist organization during Jewish Music Month. What a wonderful lecture and performance he gave us that night. Mari was also invited and performed before Dr. Chaim Weizmann and David Ben-Gurion. At this time, I would like to express my appreciation to my committee, especially my co-chairperson, Sarah Rain, and the Temple office staff for helping to make this evening possible this evening. The funds raised here tonight and at future events will be used to perpetuate his memory and love of Jewish music. A short time after Mari's untimely death, a young man came upon Temple Emmett's scene and was quickly embraced by us as a person qualified to follow Mr. Blyweiss's footsteps. Gennady Konnikoff became musical director of Temple Emmett in 1987. His father, Abraham Meir, who was a chassid in the Moscow synagogue, taught him Hebrew language and Hebrew literature. Gennady holds an MA degree from the Tchaikovsky Moscow Conservatory and a diploma from the Moscow College of Music. He has taught piano, solfeggio, and choral singing, both in the Soviet Union and the United States. Mr. Konnikoff has published compositions for piano, voice, and choir through the State Publishing House of the USSR, and he has had his works performed on Moscow radio as well as in Boston. I have participated in the voluntary choir organized by Mr. Karakoff at Temple Emmett. And even though I must confess he is a demanding taskmaster and perfectionist, all of us in the choir have acquired tremendous personal satisfaction under his tutelage. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm pleased to introduce to you Mr. Gennady Karakoff.
Thank you, Warren. Good evening, everybody. It's nice to see you here this evening, and I hope it will be memorable for everybody. I would like to remind you a few lines from Psalm 150. Halleluhu b'deka shofar, halleluhu b'nevel tikanot. Praise him with the sound of trumpet, praise him with the sound of the harp. For almost half a century, Moni Blaibas served God, the Torah, and this temple through his dedication to music. Although I personally never had the privilege to meet Mr. Blaibas, I feel that I know him through his compositions and notes that he has left behind. His music has outlasted his life and remained the paragon of Mr. Blaibas' devotion to Hebrew literature. His music demonstrates sensitivity, expressiveness in carefully crafted melodies. We can see the composer's approach to music and life through his work. It is to preserve, cherish, and create. At times, it seems to me that Mr. Blaibas anticipated the person who will replace him at the organ. He left clear, detailed, and precise notes about the music and the service. His performance and talent will be never forgotten. It is almost 5 years since Cantor Kemper introduced me to wonderful music of Mr. Blaibas. At last, through our performance tonight, Moritz Blaibas' compositions are receiving the respect they deserve. It was my pleasure to watch the enthusiasm of Zamir Peral singers as they discover Mr. Blaibas' choral music. Please welcome Zamir Peral of Boston under the leadership of Professor Joshua Jacobson.
Happy to be back at Temple Emmett. We performed in this room a number of times, and I was just recalling as we walked through the vestry through there that it was in 1970 or 71, maybe someone can help me out, but some here performed one of our very first concerts for the Brotherhood Breakfast on a Sunday morning a long time ago. So we're old friends and happy to be back with you. The first part of our program is dedicated to a city that is very special in our hearts, and of course, in the hearts of all Jews. And in 2 weeks from today, we will celebrate a very important anniversary. So join us now as we begin this portion of our concert with a musical journey to Jerusalem. In 2 weeks, we will celebrate the 25th anniversary of Yom Yerushalayim, the day on which we removed the barbed wire that pierced the heart of Jerusalem, the day on which the ancient prophecy of Isaiah came true.
Rejoice in Jerusalem, all you who love that city. Fear not, for your enemies shall flee before you. Look around you. Look at your people who have returned to you. Rejoice.
And Jerusalem, Giluvah, Giluvah, Kolo Abel HaKolo Abel HaSisu.
And Jerusalem, Giluvah, Giluvah.
Become like a widow. the princess among the states has become a slave. Our inheritance has been turned over to strangers. We have become orphans, fatherless. For Mount Zion lies desolate. By the waters of Babylon, by the waters of many Babylons, there we sat down. Yea, we wept when we remembered you, O Zion. If I forget you, O Jerusalem, let my right hand forget its cunning. Let my tongue cleave to the roof of my mouth. If I do not place Jerusalem above my cheapest Jerusalem, I shall never leave this place. Oh, Jerusalem, day soon the Messiah will come.
Yerushalayim, 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 Yerushalayim,
thousand years, the shofar once again sounds from the heart of Jerusalem, summoning the people to joyous occasion. Jerusalem will never again be divided. The ancient words of Isaiah have come true.
Rise up from the ashes, O Jerusalem. You shall never again be occupied by foreigners. Rise up, adorn yourself with strength and glory.
Urit Zion, Urit Zion, Urit Zion, Urit Zion, Urit Zion, Urit Zion,
Urit Zion, Urit Zion, Urit Zion, Urit Zion, Urit Zion, Urit Zion, Urit Zion, Urit
Roxbury. And they had 5 different houses in Roxbury before they finally bought a house in Newton and another house in Sharon. Bernstein, of course, became a great composer and teacher and conductor. His father, of course, wanted him to become a rabbi. Or if not a rabbi, at least going to his business, which was selling beauty supplies. But a klezmer, never! How could you make a living as a klezmer? Let me show you. Years later, they asked Sam Bernstein, the father, why did you object so strenuously to your son becoming a musician? How did I know that he was going to be Leonard Bernstein? So, Lenny wrote a number of pieces of Jewish music, and here's one of the first ones that he wrote, the setting of the folk song, Sifuna.
Thank you.
Composer born in Germany and completely took over that country, was able to complete, and eventually made his way to America. Kurt Weill is perhaps best known for his collaborations with the playwriter Bertolt Brecht. Among the most famous of his musicals, his operas, was one called the Three Penny Opera, from which you may remember some notable songs, including Mack the Knife. Some true social commentary. Kurt Weill was the son of a cantor. In the last year of his life, in 1950, he was commissioned by cantor David Putterman of the Park Avenue Synagogue in New York to write the setting of the Friday evening sanctification of the wine, the Kiddush. You will now hear that setting. So picture, if you will, Mack the Knife, blessing the wine.
Became a classic, but not through the Yiddish theater, but through a rendition by
John Baez, and that was the song Dona Dona, written by Charles Segunda. In addition to his prolific output for the Yiddish theater, he also wrote some wonderful settings of the liturgy. And so we will listen now to his setting of the Pesach Hallel Psalm 118. Open for me the gates of righteousness that I might enter. Is kuli shaharei tzeva. Solomon, who serves now at Temple Abai Shalom in Boston, also very well known. arranger and lead singer for the band Satpam. Rami has written a number of compositions that we have performed. This is a delightful one, setting again at the Hallel Zan in a neo-Hasidic style, in the Sephardic dialect. So we now sing Pizza Kool.
Thank you.
we've what have been the possessions of a vast oil reserve in the Middle East. With Rabbi Turitz's background and quality of voice, had he turned to the left, the conservative movement would have had a wonderful canter. Instead, he turned to the right, and we were blessed with an articulate and brilliant rabbi. I do not know of any temples in the area in which the rabbi and the cantor sing duets, and they're in perfect harmony. Rabbi Turitz.
Cantor, how do you feel tonight?
I'll sing with a cantor anytime, God bless him. I think of Maury, I think of the cantor. I mentioned years ago they had a friendship like Jonathan and David, of biblical fame, and indeed that friendship is still felt in many ways today. I'm extremely pleased that Cantor Candler is going to be soloist for that part of the concert which features Maury's music. Again, Cantor, bravo. I'd like to ask Maury's family were here tonight to rise. Judy and Paul, Joel and Irene, Aunt Anne, would you please rise so we can give you a round of applause? I would also like to take a moment to ask Morty Zeidman and Sarah Rain, co-chair people, to rise as well. Moment to ask the rest of the committee whose names are featured on the program to rise. They were all wonderful. Please, everyone on the committee. Let me introduce you on the committee. The people on the committee in their own way to be disciples of Maury Blythe. I wanted to share with you a brief thought before we resume the concert that deals with a question that speaks, it seems to me, to the significance of this concert in honor of Maury and Bertha Blythe. How do we decide, and on what basis do we decide, the kind of honor that we accord to our peers? What criteria do we use in order to extend accolades to those to whom we wish to empathize with and honor? And our sages were very concerned with this question and referred our attention to the book of Proverbs, where we read, the refining pot for silver, the furnace for gold, and man according to his praise, ish lafi mahalalo. In other words, the true essence of silver and gold is tested through the refining process. So too, according to the verse, is the character of a person. It is gauged, according to this verse, Lefi Mahalalo, according to his praise, meaning, at least on its face, according to a person's reputation. Public opinion provides a certain standard to guide us as to a person's deserving worth. Now, we would agree with this only to some extent. Certainly, the crucible of modern-day politics has taught us that public opinion is not everything, nor is it often fully informed. In fact, sometimes public opinion reveals more about the standards of the public than it does about the individual it presumes to judge. And so I bring to your attention what I consider to be the most penetrating analysis of how we really accord honor to another human being. One of the sages suggested that when the verse in Proverbs says, man according to his praise, ish lafi mahalalo, it does not mean that we gauge a person's reputation simply by public opinion. Rather, it means that we gauge a person by what he praises, by what he esteems, by what he chooses to honor in his own life, Ish Lafi Mahalalo, judge a person according to what he praises. Judge him according to what evokes his support, his ardor, his zeal, his enthusiasm. And that's how I think of Morgan. What evokes his praise and his enthusiasm? First of all, without question, his family. Bertha, whom he loved as his own life, Judy, Joel, their spouses, the grandchildren, his siblings, they evoke the kind of love in Mori which still today transforms the lives of those who receive that love in immeasurably enriching ways. The second thing that evoked Mori's enthusiasm, of course, as we all know, was his music. Not only as a remarkably gifted composer, an outstanding organist and pianist, but to me, as one whose tone on the instrument that he played near the organ reflected his personality. It was a gentle, warm, vibrant, sweet sound that I've never heard duplicated and reflected precisely his gifts and his personality. Languages evoked his enthusiasm. Hebrew, Yiddish, Italian, French, Polish, German, Hungarian, I believe. I used to see him studying from those dictionaries. He never spent an idle moment. Knowledge and beauty in all of its forms evoked his enthusiasm and his praise. From lectures that he would attend at the museum and speak with me about those lectures before services on Shabbat morning, to a myriad of different kinds of books that he read, to the kind of artistic experience of every dimension in which he so reveled. Finally, and perhaps above all, people evoked Mori's enthusiasm. We are in the midst of Sphira counting the Omer, and someone asked me, ought we to have a concert in the midst of the Omer? And I responded, the kind of concert that this represents is consummately fitting. First of all, as we count the Omer, nobody was more a master of counting than Mori Bleiweis, not simply in terms of the metronome and the proper phraseology in a bar of music, but Mori made everyone count. Anyone who ever spent a minute with Mori felt like they counted. That was the kind of empathy we felt from him. Just today at 4 p.m, I was speaking to a young man from this congregation and describing the concert that we were to have tonight. And he said that I, meaning this young man, was a student at Kehillat Israel as a kid. And Mori Bleiweis was one of his teachers. And he told me that the class of which he was a member was rambunctious beyond description. They tried to skip school, they left, they cut, they went to the store. But for Mori Bleiweis, he said, they went to class. They wanted to be with him. Even then, and at their age, they felt that sweetness in the man, which he remembers vividly today, and described to me in very moving terms. The kids felt it. One of the members of Zamir, just before I spoke tonight, the soloist, the tenor soloist who sang so beautifully the Pitchuli, told me that Mori started him off in camp. And it was Mori that developed his love of singing, his love of music.
For 35 years, or the 50 years, I have served this congregation. Mori Bleiweis was my organist, choir leader, and musical director. He was a quiet person. Music was his life, and he expressed it with deep feeling. He was modest and humble. He knew Hebrew well and understood fully what the prayers were all about. This knowledge of Hebrew enabled him to grasp the depth of the prayers and their divine message. He played the organ with remarkable dexterity, and the musical instrument responded to the directions of the maestro. The entire congregation was greatly inspired and followed him with a deep feeling of worship and prayer. Mary Blymas has left us, but the melody of his life lingers on here at Temple Emmet. We, in turn, will continue to cherish his song of his life. Tehin ishmas hau zur Rav Yitzhar Hachayim. May his soul be bound up in the bond of everlasting life, and may his beautiful music continue to inspire us all.
Oh, God, heart its law.
It's the heart of its law. It's the heart of its law. Let all men be sure.
Ooh.
Yerushalayim Ir Harshecha Kasur Divrei Harshecha Yimla Adonai Le'olam Elohai Etzion Le'kor Thank you.
for the duration of our program, we'd like to take you on a tour around the world. It won't take long, though. This being the 500th anniversary of the Sephardic diaspora, we begin with the music of the Sephardic Jews. And our first selection is a wonderful example of a mingling of different cultures. The story of this song, it tells the story of a baby whose miraculous birth in the Holy Land was foretold by constellations and the stars, and the king looked up and he knew that this baby was going to be born. The wise men came to bring gifts for this baby from all over the Orient, gifts for the baby and the Mohel and the parents and the godfather. Of course, the baby is none other than Abraham Avinu, our father Abraham, Luz de Israel, light of Israel.
Thank you. Thank you. Oh, Pain we learned so long ago.
the Maccabees and for all those heroes who kept their faith alive, who lit up the darkness around them with their undying hope, who kept alive their dreams, childhood dreams of a better world, a sweeter world, a world of ideals and truth. You remember those dreams, don't you? Light one candle for Anne Frank, hiding for 2 years in a secret room in Amsterdam, while the darkness of the Nazi storm shut out what should have been her light. Anne was 15 years old in July of 1944 when she wrote, "In spite of everything, I still believe that people are really good at heart. I simply can't build up my hopes on a foundation consisting of confusion, misery, and death. I see the world gradually being turned into a wilderness. I can hear the ever-approaching thunder, which will destroy..."